Okay, so now players are actually entering. We're in a lobby. That's all good. So the primary stream is actually in French, obviously, because the tournament is in France and they're all there together. They actually flew the teams in for this. So FishStix and I are providing an alternative English cast for you guys.
Yes, indeed. Joshy, I just realized I'm not sure which team is which. We're going to have to figure that out real quick.
There should be an easy way to do that. I believe the Meltdown Bar's Twitter actually did tweet.
They tweeted their, the rosters? Okay.
Their rosters recently, so we just have to go back a little bit.
They could also set the names in game, hopefully. Hopefully they'll do that.
Pablo is on the random Raptors team from Budapest.
Okay, got it. All right.
But it looks like there's a mix of players right now, just chilling. Because Hikleri is also on Pablo's team, and they're on different teams in the lobby currently. But we'll get that sorted.
You know, Joshy, this is a little bit nostalgic, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
We haven't cast it in a while.
That's true. What would be the last time? Probably London.
London. Right, that
August.
Thing. Yeah, it's been like 5 or 6 months since we've casted, and a little bit of Overwatch history. We commentated some of the very first tournaments in this game's life, back in what was it,
the
like November 2015?
Yeah, closed beta started like the last week of October in 2015, and then we started running stuff immediately, obviously.
How crazy is it to think that it's been like that long?
Well,
it's been like a full year and a half since we've been playing this game.
Time flies when you're having fun, Ben.
Yeah.
So I feel like we just got started. I don't know, man. It has been a long road. I've cast 70 tournaments since then.
Damn!
Yeah. Lots of weeklies, obviously, in that mix. But Rivalcade is actually a big one for that just because of their consistency. But yeah, it's been, I've cast a lot of tournaments now, and obviously played a bajillion games as well now that we're in competitive season 4 already. That's actually a little bit surprising, is that we're already in the fourth competitive season. But I hope we keep getting more new stuff every single time. I want to see, I think more maps honestly would be great for the game if they keep churning them out.
Yeah, absolutely. I feel like the pace of updates has been pretty decent. We've gotten either a new map, a new hero, or a new set of skins and fun stuff like that. Like, what feels like every 2 months or so, which is, seems like it's like an okay pace. It's pretty good. But I sort of do agree. Right now, I kind of, in a weird way, I almost get more excited about a new map than a new hero. Like, Orisa's cool, and she's fun, and I like playing her, and she's going to change the meta, but there's something exciting always about a new map, for me at least.
Yeah. Currently, I mean, we have way more characters than maps, right? So we're just on the same playgrounds over and over.
Yeah.
It's just fun to have new stuff to, like, explore. I guess Orisa is still very new to the game, and I haven't actually given her, you know, a million hours yet to figure out how to be an expert on the current maps, but just even the old characters, Pharah, Tracer, etc., learning new jumps and tricks and blinks and all that stuff is what I really enjoy. And I think that goes back to my old flag running experience from Unreal Tournament. Just trying to abuse terrain and line of sight and all that stuff is exciting for me. But we are here, obviously, to cast English for the Meltdown City Clash Grand Finals. This tournament's been taking place over the course of months, and this is the exciting conclusion about to take place.
Yeah, we're coming to it. It's going to be Budapest, Hungary, the Meltdown Bar from Budapest, Hungary. Oh, wait, I shouldn't do that. I keep messing up my Skype window. Oh, my bad. So we have one bar that was located in Budapest, Hungary, which qualified through a pretty big bracket. I think there was like 16 different bars that participated in this originally. So Budapest, Hungary versus Grenoble, France. Those two bars about to go to head-to-head, and they are playing live from Lyon, France as well. If you're just tuning in, we're casting the Meltdown City Clash Grand Finals in just a couple of minutes. We'll get started. We're almost there, team. Sit tight.
They have some interesting team names as well, by the way. It's the Grenoble Mountain Butchers versus the Budapest Random Raptors. So I like those team names. I wonder if they came up with them or if they're just like assigned that at their Meltdown bar.
Random Raptors. Yeah, I don't know if those names were given or not. I actually like the logos, though.
Yeah.
These teams have like they made pretty great graphics. I'll just show you some of the in-game graphics we have right now. Yeah, the teams have really cool logos and all that.
I think the bars must have picked, like, because they're so uniform, you know, like the Budapest, the actual fonts on them are the same. I think Meltdown actually may have just given them some team names, but they're pretty sweet icons. I agree. I would like to see the Mountain Butchers expand to other games.
Honestly, these are better logos than some mainstream esports teams. Exactly. Let's be real about this for a second.
You know who had the worst team logo of all time and no one ever talked about it? Was Titan. Titan Esports had the worst logo. It didn't even look like a T or anything, but then they actually dissolved about a year ago, so I guess it's not a big deal anymore. But I was always baffled by Titan's team logo and why they never switched to something cooler. But I guess we're off topic a little bit, but
all good. Yeah, I think we're pretty close to getting this started, so get hype.
So FishStix, do you know the format of this grand final that we're doing here? Is it BO5, BO7, BO5? Okay. Sweet. All right, looks like the teams are actually on the correct sides now. So it's going to be the Grenoble Mountain Butchers on that blue team there. And the Budapest Random Raptors on the red side.
Just trying to get you guys a feed from within the bar itself. That's the last thing we're trying to figure out here. And it doesn't seem to be playing nice with me right now. I'm not sure why. We'll try to get that sorted later on in the cast. But for now, you'll just be stuck with us.
Oh, I see that overlays for the actual stage setup that they have.
So by the way, guys, you can check out ESL_AlphaCast. That's the main stream. That's the French stream. That's what we're trying to capture for the in-bar scene. So if we can't get that working, that's where it's going to be. We're just waiting on one player, and we're going to be getting into the games any second now. It's Grenoble versus Budapest. Hungary versus France. Who's going to take it? Probably have a home team favorite here, because this is the finals taking place in Lyon, France. So I certainly imagine we're going to have some pretty hype people in the audience at that bar, at that Meltdown location.
Probably. They've got the home field advantage, even if they're not in the same city. At least they've got the language on their side. They were actually just talking about it in the lobby, how difficult Hungarian is for foreigners to try to pronounce.
I believe it. I actually don't know anything about Hungarian at all.
French is a bit easier, though. I actually survived a trip to Paris, so that says something. Yep. Good old Nadio Studios brought us out. I hope those guys are doing well. I really wonder where the Shoot Mania devs are these days. Hmm. I am not too familiar with OBS. Is it just a screen region? Are you capturing screen region or a window?
I was capturing a window, and it's like just not working. Anyway, we'll try and figure it out.
All right, I'm gonna write out a tweet, let people know that we're about to begin here. I'll just send it when we actually do go live.
Well, the AlphaCast stream has gone offline. Not sure what that's all about.
Wow.
So
maybe that's why your clean feed doesn't work.
Yeah, I don't know. Something like that.
Oh, man.
All right, we'll give you the in-game feed so you can see the banter between the teams leading up into this grand finals. All the players are in here. I think probably the last thing we're waiting for is just AlphaCast to get back online. Hopefully that will happen sooner than later. We can get this thing kicked off. It's a best of five. Meltdown, Grenoble versus Meltdown in Budapest. Should be good.
I'm checking out all the players on both sides, and I actually have a higher SR than Eraldos on the Grenoble side.
Okay. What are the averages we're looking at here?
Average for Grenoble appears to be around 3,900, maybe 4K.
That's not bad, you know. That's not bad at all, considering, like, this is not a pro, I'm using air quotes, a pro tournament for,
Budapest has a 3K player, though. Okay. 2966 current.
I mean, that's still not terrible, considering the circumstances here. Again, these folks played within the bars in their own cities and their hometowns and their home locations to qualify for this tournament, so by no means a pro tournament, but still does look like most people sitting high masters to GM range, which is a good sign. We got some good games coming our way.
Yeah, I think the only oddball here that I see at all is Z Soccer is about 3K and everyone else is right around 4K. So maybe he's the Lucio player or something.
Yeah,
like that.
I was literally about to say, how much would you bet that he's playing Lucio for them? Not to say that Lucio doesn't require skill. Lucio does require skill. In fact, you can carry as Lucio. I know this for a fact because I do it all the time in ranked. My Lucio win rate is insane. Because, you just throwing that sound barrier out at the right millisecond is the difference between winning and losing a team fight, you know? So.
True. And Lucio is the support that I always default to if I am forced to actually heal people. But then I always tell people, hey, I don't like to heal and my win rate isn't great, so I'd rather tank in DPS, but I'm going to play Lucio as hard as I can. We're going to try to win this.
That's me usually whenever...
Yeah, go ahead.
That's me whenever I'm forced to play Ryan. I'm like, okay, I'm really not that good, but I'll do it if I absolutely need to. Yeah.
I'll take one for the team. You guys better kill everything, basically, is how it feels for me. It looks like some of the teams are asking for a cigarette break already. We haven't even started.
Classic Europeans.
Oh, yeah.
All right. And look at these team names. It's not just the Budapest versus Grenoble here. You got the Mountain Butchers versus the Random Raptors. They're interesting names.
Jeez. I would be terrified of Mountain Butchers. Just six dudes.
It's a scary thought.
Oh, could be. Yeah.
Mountain Butchers sounds brutal.
Mountain Butchers, but their icon looks like a lumberjack, which I don't know if I would describe a lumberjack as a mountain butcher. So I guess they're chopping up animals somewhere. And the Random Raptors are animals, so perhaps they'll be feasting on raptor meats tonight.
They're talking about grills in chat. If anyone speaks French, just let me know what they're actually talking about. That'd be great.
I do, though.
You do?
Yeah. Oh. I took 3 years of French in high school, and I'm still able to read most of it.
I took like 8 years of Spanish throughout elementary and in high school, and you know, it doesn't really help much.
So Resist says, I am alone, my friend. Someone says, very good French. Someone says, I speak a little. I said, me too. And then I said, I speak a little French. That's it. I think the Hungarians are testing out their French on the Grenoble team.
All right, so it still looks like Alpha Cast's stream is not quite up yet, so we'll be getting that going as soon as Alpha Cast is up and ready to go. Hopefully not too long from now, but thanks everyone for tuning in this fine Saturday morning, evening if it's Europe. This is actually, it should be about a 2 hour broadcast. We're looking at a best of five to decide who is the champion of the City Clash. And these teams, does look like we're looking at the mid-high Masters range on average. So should be some decent games going forward. I'm not sure exactly how they're selecting maps, Joshy, but we'll find out as we get forward. Actually, look at this. Is that a top 500 there for Pyronil, which is good for the Butchers? Because, like you said, they do have a 3K player on their team, so they do have someone who has hit that top 500 range.
Says, we start on Nepal. Okay, I get that. And I guess it's probably a loser's pick from that point, just to stay with the theme of competitive Overwatch. I forgot the rest of the maps. That's funny. Well, you only have to know the first three if you win them all. All right. Okay, yeah, it just says loser will choose. But there's also King's Row, Route 66, Hollywood, and Lijiang Tower.
Okay. No 2CP.
Yay! Yeah, actually, I like this mix. Good mix.
All right, the AlphaCast stream is live.
Woo.
We are getting closer and closer.
And looks like AlphaCast is getting ready up. It could be time.
We're almost there. Yes, I got the word. We're live. It's going down.
Excellent.
All right, Joshy, let's get ready to cast this grand finals. It's going to be Grenoble Mountain Butchers versus Budapest's Random Raptors. Starting off here on Nepal.
Excellent stuff. Finally, we are going to jump in only about 45 minutes after the proposed start time. So thank you so much to the people joining us already. I just sent out another tweet to let people know that the games are actually live now. But it's going to be the, as you said, Grenoble Mountain Butchers versus the Budapest Random Raptors. And the Random Raptors will be on the red team this time. So we've got some alliteration to help us remember Random Raptors red. Not too hard there, and you can see some of the characters they're locking in already. Looks like it's going to be pretty much a full dive composition for Grenoble to start us off.
All right, here we go. Teams are just going to start getting ready here in their own ships, and we'll see who comes out with an early advantage in this best of five. Of course, starting here on beautiful Nepal. This is the first time I'm actually running cameras for a Overwatch tournament in many, many months. I'm actually kind of excited. This is going to be cool.
One thing to do when you go into third person, I think it's Control H is what I have it set to, but it's turned health bars on permanently. I don't know if you need to set the hotkey or if that's what it started out as.
Oh, I don't have that on. It does not seem to be working, but here we go. Starting things up.
Later. Yeah. So you said, May Josh, is actually being used. Resist actually putting up the Maywall and trapping a lot of Grenoble there, but no kills just yet. Keck on the Winston is actually going to be the first one down.
All right, so it is a dive comp here fully for Grenoble. It is. Sort of.
It is.
They do have the 76, but that is actually kind of a part of the dive comp now, is keeping that 76. The long-range poke, of course, makes it that much easier for Genjis to get dash resets, Winston's to survive, and a first capture will be going over to Grenoble.
Yeah, Soldier plus Genji plus Tracer has been pretty much the dialed-up dive composition recently, with Winston as your solo tank, and then Lucio plus Anna as your healers. But Soldier can be kind of a variable. You can mix him with Pharah for maps that make more sense to be shooting rockets rather than the Soldier 76 on high ground, for example. But as we get back in here, it's going to be Hikleri, Tracer, first eating a Bionade and going down. Pancake the Winston, also getting eliminated there. And it looks like the Budapest team is actually having a tough time trying to break back in here. Genji already diving to the backline. Twinkie has the Dragon Blade out, and he's slicing already. Z Soccer, the Lucio, is going to be down. There goes Alien Hunt 28 as well. And now there's no supports left for the Budapest team.
Yeah, Budapest looking in a little bit of a rough spot, but it's still somewhat even. Here comes the Dragon Blade here now for the Raptors, and they're actually going to be able to capture this after being a bit down there. It's going to be that Dragon Blade pulling them right back into this, and here comes the next cap for the Raptors.
Oh, a late Pulse Bomb going out there from Sarens misses, but he also gets eliminated. So good job, Budapest, actually breaking back in here. I've got to give some props to Hikleri, the Tracer. Even though he was the first one dead in the engagement, he made his way back and actually did a really good job bouncing from target to target, helping finish off those low-health victims there. But we've got Grenoble breaking right back in here. Heraldos, the Lucio, is going to be the first one down, so missing that healer is going to hurt a bit. Keck is going to go ahead and use his Primal Rage, and that triggers Pancake to use his as well. So they're having a bit of a slap fight out here toward the spawn area. Keck is going to be the first one down, and this gives Grenoble the chance to move in. Tactical Visor is going to be activated by Pyro. He finds two kills right away, and that gives Grenoble a great chance to try and break back in here.
Yeah, here comes Grenoble off the back of that attack visor. They're going to do a really good job of cleaning the point up, recapturing now with 61% on the point. That really only leaves one or two more pushes left for Budapest. That said, they do have the ultimates to make it happen. They have a pretty decent ultimate advantage for this next fight, including, of course, that all-important nano there. It does look like they've lost their soldier very early, though, so Nano Tack will have to wait for the next fight. The last fight here for Raptors, they have the ults to do it, though.
Yeah, Budapest lining up now. Looks like they want to take the high ground entrance once again, but they're mixing up a little bit, sending Tracer in through a lower side. There's the nano boost onto Genji immediately. Pablo getting some dash resets there as they found a very quick kill onto the enemy Genji and now Anna. The nano boosted Pablo did get his damage out. Didn't have an ultimate to combo it with, but the kills added up anyway. Pulse Bomb going to go flying out there from Sarens, but he dies again. without finding any targets. 41% now for Budapest as they flip the point back. 99% for Grenoble means they only have to win one more fight here to secure the stage.
Yeah, that said, still a decent position for Budapest Raptors here, as they do have both of their DPS ultimates, both of the big ones anyway, up and ready. That said, it will be starting to get into the favor of the other team now, as it's going to be a clash on the top. Both teams dropping ultimates left, right, and center, though Budapest still holds strong. So this fight was a pretty good one for Budapest. They not only did they win it, but it looks like they, well, actually pretty smart stuff out of Grenoble not to blow too many ults in that fight, because this last fight, they have a massive advantage. It's going to be very, very tough for Budapest to find a way to hold on against Nano, against Blade, against Monkey. It's going to be tough.
Nano, Blade, and Monkey, all very viable tools here. We've got a Dragon Blade coming in immediately here from the blue team. It's going to be Twinkie slicing around and finds resist. The enemy soldier already down. Pyro goes down. Sounded like he was trying to activate his tactical visor. No, he actually just got cut down early. But Primal Rage here from Keck is going to be slapping those blue players away. Twinkie, the Genji, finally does go down to Keck, and it's going to be Budapest actually standing on the point when all is said and done. They're already in control of the point, so they're just going to kill off the blue attackers as they arrive, and Budapest will be the first ones with a point on the board.
They did it against a Nano Blade. That's pretty good stuff for Budapest, and bodes well for them for the rest of this best of five in the grand finals here of the Meltdown City Clash. Although that is, of course, just the very first round of the very first game, so can't read too much into it. But good to see them holding against really poor odds, actually. So moving on to Sanctum now.
99-99 gives us a pretty good indicator of how closely these teams are matched. And I do want to point out again, the only 3K player in the lobby is Z Soccer on the team that won that point. So he is playing the Lucio as we expected, but he did an admirable job there just staying alive and helping his team out. And we've got now the doors about to open for Sanctum. There is a Pharah in play. Twinkie is off the Genji. Onto Pharah, and we've also got Reinhardt in play for Grenoble. Pancake is going to be leading up that push.
I'm kind of interested by the Pharah. I feel like Pharah on this point is actually kind of difficult. There isn't a ton of room to maneuver. Of course, there are some line of sight blockers that you can use to keep yourself a little bit safer, though. Twinkie making me eat my words, getting that first kill pretty well here. But yeah, what do you think about Pharah on this first point?
Pharah, the only problem she usually has is not like getting killed, but actually finding a lot of damage. So Twinkie is actually doing a really good job just dipping down into the pit, keeping line of sight, playing around that column, and that is the best place for Pharah to hang out, especially when you've got an Ana in play like they do, because Ana can just kind of stay with you, and Pharah can play bodyguard. Environmental kills are huge as well, though, and you see Z-Soccer actually gets a boop kill onto Pancake's Reinhardt. Pharah's also going to go down here, and Budapest might be the first ones to claim the point.
Yeah, that was actually looking great for Grenoble for a second there, but a clutch sleep dart shuts down Twinkie, allowing his friendly McCree to get that kill, and that's going to be it. Budapest starting off pretty strong here on Sanctum, and there's an early kill. They're going to just use that ult, and I don't disagree with that move at all by Hi Clary. Hi Clary? Dropping the pulse bomb there. He's just going to be, of course, staggering the enemy team for that much longer as they new come in.
Yeah, I think Hikleri has to get some props for his Tracer. I think out of the two Tracers that we've seen so far, he has been getting the better end of ultimates and just individual kills. Resist is going to pop the Deadeye from long range and actually finds the kill onto Pancake's Reinhardt. Budapest is surging now. They've got the Nano Boost onto Keck. He's going to force everyone back out of that spawn room area toward the shuttle itself. And if they get this Soldier kill here, that's another great stacker. They can actually run away from this and be sure that they're going to get another 10-15%. So Budapest, excellent job so far, just keeping full control on Sanctum.
Yeah, up to 50%, and looks like pretty even for ultimates for both teams, so this next fight could be a wild one, as we're going to probably see a couple ultimates drop for both teams. Twinkie holding onto that barrage, let's see if he can make any use for it. He's in a good position to do so. Lots of red enemies below him, but no deaths because of the sound barrier. Well-placed sound barrier by Z-Soccer.
It looked like Twinkie hit the barrage but didn't get any kills with it. I think that Pablo was actually there reflecting a lot of those rockets.
Yeah, that as
he
well.
He didn't get any killing blows either. It was enough damage to easily fold over them. And resist on the McCree actually for a while now has been unchallenged because the Grenoble team can't even seem to get through the front door here.
All right, Grenoble, one last chance. They don't have a lot of time left. 10 seconds to be exact. This is their time to make it happen. Of course, they do have The nano boost, who are they gonna put it on? Maybe Monkey. They gotta get in there now though. Who's on the point?
I see it is gonna be Pancake catching the nano boost. That Winston is gonna leap directly onto Alien Hun and get the kill. So Budapest are on the back foot a little bit. Actually, neither side has Ana in play. And now we're down to a 4v4 on the point. Mostly DPS characters out there. Sarens is gonna dodge a pulse bomb expertly, but Pancake's Winston's still taking care of business.
You know, Winston so strong right now in the meta, and you can really see why. The fact that his shield has, what is it, 6 seconds less cooldown now? Maybe even 8 seconds less cooldown? It's just actually made Winston so much more powerful. It's going to be Grenoble cleaning that up and starting to get some points on the board here on the second point of Nepal.
Yeah, it's the cooldown just triggers from when the bubble is placed rather than when it's destroyed. So yeah. it could be a range of time, actually, that
yeah,
it's buffed
that's
by.
Correct.
But we've got Winston's actually battling in the back here. Pancake's going to get surrounded by four of Budapest's players and goes down very quickly. Resist on the McCree is going to be the first victim on their side. Hakleri also going down means only a few members are still standing. Pablo actually gets very low health on the Genji. He has to back out of there. Pyro finds the Helix Rocket kill onto Alien Hunt 28. That's another great kill onto the enemy Ana, and it's going to give Grenoble even more percentage here. Z-Soccer also going to go down, and Budapest will need to rally together here. They don't want to risk trickling back in when... all they have to do is win one fight. If they can group up, hit the ults right, they can walk away with another victory on this stage.
Yeah, and Joshy, I think they have a great opportunity to do so. Of course, they've got Nano Blade sitting and waiting, and here it comes. Here comes the blade out of Pablo. What kind of value will he be able to get? No, it's actually Resist going to get the first kill. And this is looking great for Budapest, 99%. Can Grenoble make any play here whatsoever? No, the Pulse Bomb whiffs, and it's going to be the Budapest Raptors taking the second point here on Sanctum.
Well, we have Winston jump in using Primal Rage, landed just in time to keep the overtime going, but as he gets exploded, that is going to be it. 2-0 on Nepal so far. We're going to move on to the Shrine as the third stage of Nepal, but so far, Budapest do seem to be in control of this match. Grenoble, keeping it interesting, did manage to flip it back one time, but they've definitely got the improvement to show here. They need to battle back here and win three rounds straight if they want to grab this first game.
All right, so Shrines is the next point, and it's do or die now for this first map in the best of five. Grenoble has to get on the board, otherwise this first map will be going the way of their opponents from Budapest, Hungary. And if you're just tuned in, we are commentating for you the Meltdown City Clash Grand Finals. These teams qualified through a series of in-person well, actually, they're playing in person in their own home bars, their home Meltdown locations. They've qualified over weeks to get to this final place. They're actually playing in Lyon, France right now in a live setting. So we're going to be commentating this Grand Finals for you as we do get things kicked off here on Shrine.
All right, the Winstons, of course, are going to be driving the action, both of them diving to the opposite sides. And Keck and Hakleri both fell very short on life, but Alien Hun, he's going to be the first one eliminated, and I think they're kind of picking on him at this point. He is on Mercy this time around to pair with Resist's Pharah. I think Pharah actually has a much tougher time on this point than she does on Sanctum, so that's kind of an interesting choice by Budapest, but they do seem to be getting the better end of the kills anyway. Pablo on the Genji has been a delight for them and actually helps Budapest claim the point first.
Oh, big time. Pablo has been very clutch. Pyronel, though, getting a kind of surprise kill. So things are looking okay for this next engagement, perhaps. Grenoble, at least an even footing now as they do make their way forward. Budapest with the early capture, but here they come. Looks like High Noon will be on the way very soon here. High Noon is up, but it's very difficult ultimate to use without dying. That said, already in a bad position for Grenoble. Will we see this High Noon come out? I'm going to be watching Pyron. Oh no, actually got his flashbang reflected and already spiraling out of control. Grenoble was on even footing, but completely shut down in that engagement.
Yeah, I think they lost their Genji at a kind of an odd timing. I think Keck managed to find the kill onto Twinkie. So when Pyro walked in, he was actually kind of on his own, and it just did not work out for him. As you mentioned, he's got actually Deadeye still available for him. Pablo on the other side does have Dragon Blade, but he goes down to some nice shots there from the McCree. Barrage overhead, perfect positioning, but she gets put to sleep during the ultimate, and Pyro finds the kill there. Pancake also getting in on the action as Pyro goes down. This could be Grenoble's best chance to actually break in here. The nano boost is probably a bit excessive as they had, I believe, most of those kills locked up, but they will for sure grab the point back here.
Yeah, actually a pretty unfortunate waste of that nano boost. Because they, of course, have Tac Visor up now, which is a lot more powerful when you have that nano boost juicing it up, making that DPS so, so high. But here we go. First cap on Shrine here for Grenoble underway. Let's see how long they can hold on to it, though. We will have Nano Blade coming out shortly here for the Raptors.
All right, Budapest looping around to the ledge side here, using the sound barrier to engage with and the speed boost to send everyone right up there. There's a sound barrier on the other side as well. Pablo and Sarens both finding kills. Sarens hopping over to the soldier. Seems to be a bit of an improvement here for Grenoble. Twinkie finds a kill with his own Dragon Blade. So we had just mass ults flying out, and it does seem to be Grenoble with the better body count on the point. So they should be able to maintain here and extend their, actually not extend their lead. They're just still trying to catch up, get up to that 70% Budapest already set.
Okay, so the Nano Blade did not make any value there, not much at all. So Grenoble got to feel pretty good about that one, holding on to the point and seeing their team waste Sound Barrier, Nano, and Blade all at once. That said, look at this, Ana already getting close to another Nano immediately after that fight. Oh wow, Heck, big play.
Wow. Nice pulse bomb damage coming out there. Keck is able to get the finishing blows there with the Tesla cannon, but Resist gets a kill as well, and that is going to be Budapest with just an extremely strong start here. Grenoble trying to fight back, actually do use the Primal Rage. You still got Twinkie in the mix trying to take out the Tracer, but Hecleri still doing a very good job darting around, keeping himself alive, and taking out those threats. 70% now for Budapest as they flip it back, 80 for Grenoble. So they're in a position where they could still try to win this point, but if they can't get it done, Budapest will take this Nepal map 3-0 to start us off.
Well, a huge early pick there for Sorens is going to make this a 6-5. They need to capitalize off this, get in there right now, and they're going to do just that. Another kill going to Twinkie, but here comes the ever-powerful Tac Visor. Resist gets two. This is anybody's fight as people are dropping left, right, and center. No clear advantage for either team, although Budapest finally looks like they're coming out on top just barely in the end, even though they were down 5-6 in that fight. A better ult management and that nano tac just did too much work. That's going to be the first map going the way of the Budapest Raptors.
All right, Budapest Random Raptors. It's actually cut up on the screen because it's just so long, but Budapest Random Raptors victory there, and Keck actually getting to play the match honors here. I'm surprised. Maybe he got an environmental kill here in the Sanctum that we didn't notice, but oh, okay, nano boosted Winston. That'll pretty much do it.
So I have text overlays for the scores for these two teams, but somehow it's reversed. So I have a backwards one. This is awkward. I don't understand. Why would it be reversed? This makes no sense to me.
I don't know. But I'm curious now, so I'm gonna turn on the screen to check it out.
I have a backwards one. I don't understand.
I don't know. I'm gonna blame OBS because I use XSplit.
Yeah, I'm using OBS Studios for the first time, and for some reason the text is by default reversed. I don't know.
I see your backwards one.
It's not showing like this in. I don't know, guys. I don't know. Okay, we're just gonna roll with it.
All right. Well, first game, as we said, Budapest Random Raptors wrapping it up. Pretty easily there, actually, in the final stretch. I think Grenoble definitely did make it interesting. The first point was a 99%, then something like 40, then about 80. So definitely not just a walkover by any means. The 3-0 scoreline might tell a different story. But we do still have, obviously, the rest of this best of five to play out. And Random Raptors will be at the whim of the Mountain Butcher's map selection for the next one. But we've got Route 66, King's Row, I think a couple of good maps out there. And it looks like Pixie on Grenoble will be choosing King's Row for game number two. Yeah. It is,
in my opinion.
No, I agree with you. It's interesting that King's Row is basically the first map in the game with a payload at all. So King's Row was kind of like the mark that they felt they needed to improve upon when they added other payload maps, like Dorado, for example. If you just compare the two next to each other, Dorado is super wide open, tons of flanking routes and things like that. King's Row by comparison is essentially just a straight line start to finish with like one flank route here, one flank route there. But honestly, as you mentioned, it's really narrow, and that actually helps out certain characters like Pharah, for example, who can just shoot down a straight line and has a lot of air cover to work with. Zenyatta actually does pop out from time to time here on King's Row because it's more likely that he's going to be able to make use of his damage on his orbs. And I think King's Row, as you mentioned, we were casting it all the way back in the super early closed beta. It still shows up very, very often in tournaments where people are able to select their first map as the first game almost every time in weekly events, for example, because everyone is familiar with it. Everyone knows their general strategies, both on offense and defense. So they've got the most experience there. It's a pretty balanced map overall. Still a pretty good variety of characters are viable there, too. From stretch to stretch, I think the first point you're going to see different heroes than you see in the third stretch, for example, very often. So I think it's got good variety, and it's a great map still. I don't think there's any like balance changes they need to make to it or anything like that. We've seen Eichenwald actually have to have a couple of changes recently as kind of the newest payload map, but King's Row is still untouched.
Yeah, the only thing, but this is actually something that's very common on most payload maps, the only thing that feels a little bit weird sometimes is how far defense spawns back on on that second point.
The second stretch is
like, and almost every payload map is like this, honestly. If you look at there's even much worse examples like Numbani, for instance, where if you die on defense, it's like, oh, I'll see you in 20 minutes, team. Like, yeah. I'm gonna go for a jog, I'll be there when I'm there. But I guess it's obviously a design decision because it's prevalent in a lot of the payload maps.
That's true. And I mean, once the payload is started, distance is everything. And it's really rare that you actually have games end in that second stretch. Usually your overtime contesting is going to be either right near the first checkpoint or right near the last checkpoint. Second stretch is kind of like a gimme area, but can obviously create some interesting battles. And when a team does actually successfully stop someone on the second stretch, they can feel pretty good about their own odds on attack. But looks like players are just taking a little bit of break between games here. We are, of course, casting from home. They're all at a bar with a lively live audience and everything. So I'm sure it's much more festive and crazy in person than what we're experiencing here just as outside spectators.
I don't know what you're talking about, Joshy. I'm going nuts over here. I'm having the time of my life, guys. We're casting Overwatch. It's the Ask Fishy combo back. After many, many months, man, we casted probably like 20 different things together back in the day. So
a lot of stuff.
It's good to jump back on the mic with you, Josh, as we're gonna get hopefully this going pretty soon. It's Grenoble, France, the Meltdown Bar in Grenoble, France, versus the Meltdown Bar in Budapest, Hungary, and this is taking place live from Lyon. The Meltdown location there, of course, AlphaCast is over there. So if you want to check out a feed directly from that bar, you can go on to ESL_AlphaCast, check that out. Of course, it's going to be a French stream, though. So if you want to watch the English cast, stick right here. Thanks, everyone, for tuning in today.
Yeah. Hi, everybody. Hope you're having a good start to your weekend. Thanks for joining us here. And we're going to be beginning in just a minute, says AlphaCast. So hopefully that will be the case, and we'll have an excellent Game 2 for you guys in just a moment. If you don't know what you're watching at all, it is the Meltdown City Clash, where we had teams at all the different Meltdown bars basically assemble their best Overwatch teams. They battled it out to see who could move into the playoffs, and now the Grand Finals. They actually flew in these teams from Hungary and from Grenoble, France, to another part of France, but they're all there partying, and I can't imagine what it's like for these players to kind of experience the esports life, right? Because we talked about it, and these are just dudes who went to a bar to play video games and drink, and now are suddenly, you know, getting flown around the country or to other countries even to play esports tournaments. And that's something that, you know, I've never had that privilege of being invited somewhere to play, only to cast stuff. So it's got to be feel pretty cool for these guys as kind of like a grassroots tournament here.
Oh, absolutely. That would be really fun. I actually love the concept. I love the concept of Meltdown bars generally.
Mm-hmm.
I wish we had them in the U.S. We have some bars that come close. I know in...
More are popping up, too.
Yeah. Here in the Bay Area, we have AFK Lounge in San Jose, but that's really far from San Francisco.
Foundry? Does Foundry
count? We have the Foundry, but that's only twice a week. It's not like it's every single night. It's Tuesdays and Thursdays. Actually, I think they've added a few more days. But yeah, here's the thing about Meltdown is it's a franchise for which you can open your own location. All you have to do is work directly with them. I think you have to pay a license fee, but probably. then they help
That's
you.
Typical.
Then they help you get the bar set up. They help you market. They help you get all your shit in order, and open a bar wherever you want. So there are a couple locations in North America. I think we got one, Toronto. I think
that's the only one I'm aware of.
No, there's a couple.
Okay.
Yeah. They may all be in Canada. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I haven't heard about a U.S. location yet, or I would be pretty excited. I actually did get to go to the Meltdown Bar in Paris, which I believe was the very first one when I went there in 2013 with Golden Boy. So I got to check it out a little bit firsthand, and they had like Street Fighter just being projected on the wall. Anyone could sit down and play Street Fighter against each other. They had five PCs in the back of the room for anyone who wanted to queue up and play Dota or LOL. That screen was also projected somewhere else, so people could like cheer for them or make fun of them, I guess, if they wanted to. But it was just a very friendly atmosphere. All the games are kind of tucked away in the back, and it's very bar-like, you know, typical bar atmosphere up in the front, so people aren't getting too rowdy with their drinks near the equipment. That was what my major concern was going in there, is like, people are going to spill their drinks all over these PCs, but really they're just like laptops kind of sectioned off, so it's all good in the Meltdown Bar, and I'm very excited to be able to go to another one sometime in the future in North America.
I've been to the London one
myself.
I think that's the only one I've been to, actually. I'm lying. I've been to the one in Cologne. The one in Cologne, oh God. we recounted the story on a episode of The Overview a couple months back. Mm-hmm. This was at Gamescom last year. Basically, Jason Kaplan and Mitch Leslie Uber basically like coerced / tricked me and ZP into drinking this drink that was called the Dark Souls, which was a mixture of God knows what the hell that was. I mean, there's just crazy amounts of weird different alcohol. First of all, it's a really large shot, but it was part absinthe. I don't know what the other booze in it was. Part absinthe and probably a full shot of Tabasco sauce. I'm literally not even exaggerating. I could not breathe for about 20 seconds after I took the shot. I was literally gasping for breath. It was one of the worst experiences I've ever had. But that night, on the whole, that night was fantastic. It was a couple of days before the ESL tournament that we all casted back then. But anyway, that's my Meltdown story for you guys.
Oh, that's a great one.
Uber and ZP ended up staying at the bar until like 8 in the morning.
Nice.
Things happened. You can watch, you go parse through old Overview episodes if you want more details on that.
Gotcha. I actually, got the pleasure to drink with ZP on a few occasions when we were in London as well. At the pub, but it was nothing too insane. We did do some gambling on the little machines there. That was kind of fun, but other than that, pretty tame stuff. We've got now King's Row loaded up for you guys. It's going to be Serenz and company on the Grenoble side, starting off on defense. He's going to be taking the high ground as soldier, and the attacking team pretty much locked in here now. They're going to be going with Pharah Mercy combo. And they had a Junkrat locked in, which,
okay,
thank goodness they didn't keep. But Tech is going to be back over to the Winston now.
All right, I'm going to start off watching Pablo as he makes his approach. It's more or less the full dive comp here for the attacking team of Budapest. The only thing they don't have is a Lucio. Kind of interesting, opting instead to have that Mercy pocketing the Pharah. Pablo making his way to the back lines now, along with his friendly Winston. So Keck and Pablo looking to combo here. And that Winston doing tons of damage at once. But the first kill, nonetheless, still going to go to Grenoble, and Pablo has to back out. That said, he's still alive, still looking for a chance to get healed up here. But Grenoble eking out a small advantage. No, just as I say that, it's even on the point. Still going back and forth, but Grenoble will be able to hold off some nice plays, nice shots from Serenz, cleaning things up for his team.
Yeah, really importantly, Soldier and Anna survived that first fight, and McCree actually was able to pour out some damage. I'm kind of impressed by these Euro players actually sticking to their guns with McCree. Resist and Pyro both have been playing him just a little bit. But Farrah's going to be skyward now, raining rockets down onto the point. Pancake is going to need to back up just a little bit just to keep his shield intact. Keck is going to dive right into the back line here, but actually gets exploded rather than finding a nice juicy target for himself. And defense should be able to start off strong here.
Oh, but that said, Resist in a great position, taking out the Ana early there. No, gets taken down by Sorenz, who's coming home from spawn, coming back to the point. So far, Budapest been completely shut down. That said, they have not had an opportunity to use any ultimates. An incredible ultimate advantage, though, mounting for Grenoble, as they've won these first two fights pretty substantially, pretty convincingly, I should say. Here comes the ults from both sides. Paolo will draw first blood here. He's going to actually take out the Ana as well. So even though there was a big advantage for Grenoble, still looking okay here. But will Sorenz be able to even it up? He does. Keck will strike back. So looks like Budapest still with a small advantage. Not big. Not big at all. And here come the respawns now from Grenoble. We'll start piling on in. Here comes D.Va. So this fight rages on, Joshy.
Sorenz has been a bit of a hero here for the defenders. He managed to get a few kills before 100%. Going down. But now D.Va's back with the nano boost. He's going to be standing on the point. He gets put to sleep and woken right back up. Twinkie, still with about half his health here, is able to continue contesting. And Budapest haven't gotten a tick yet. Players are starting to return from spawn, and they're all here together. Hikleri throws out a pulse bomb, dies before it explodes, but does manage to trade with McCree. Twinkie on the D.Va is asleep out in no man's land, and Budapest is still actually finding kills here and there, so they're going to keep this assault going.
Oh, this is a little bit ballsy here, putting the nano boost on Pablo before he had the blade. They were probably expecting him to get a blade in that fight, but no harm, no foul. He has it now, and a big advantage in terms of men on the point here for Budapest. Doesn't even look like they need to use it here. Pablo getting a little bit aggressive, almost to a fault there, but he makes it pay off. But Pablo's going to die here. There's no surviving that, but it does look like Budapest will get the point. I don't think there's time here.
Right, the death was worth it because Genji was just so far up in their faces, there was no chance of them actually returning to the point. So three ticks will be secured all in one fight, 3 minutes and 12 seconds to get through the next stretch here. Hikleri already jumping into the back line. Very dangerous stuff when you've got D.Va and McCree right there. But Hikleri, he's showing no fear here for Budapest. Even if he does get smacked down, he just rewinds back to his team there. The part itself is moving through the choke, but the battle in the front line, they're going to commit a nano boost already. Pablo going to town here with the Dragon Blade, trying to get into that back line against McCree, already taking out D.Va. There goes McCree as well. And Pablo has already done the damage he needs, so he's going to back out, head back to his team, and the cart is about to round the first corner here. Sorenz actually getting a nano visor. Doesn't find many kills, but does keep the cart from moving.
What a weird fight. That was all over the place. If you looked at Budapest's positioning, and even their positioning still, they've been so far ahead of the cart with only one person pushing it for the second streets phase. And they're going to keep it going, though. It looks like a pretty okay advantage. There's a pulse bomb. Does get the kill on the Ryan, and that is so incredibly important here. Budapest has a massive advantage now going into this next fight. They're continuing to roll forward. Both of the tanks out of the fight now for Grenoble, and they can't even contest here. Resist is going to make sure of that with the TAC visor, pushing even further ahead of his team. And that's going to be the second cap. After a pretty slow start here, the Raptors making it happen.
Well, the defense, I think, really should consider a beefier composition here. D.Va is not really working out. I see that Twinkie's actually getting mowed down relatively quickly by every attacker, and Pyro going down again here to Pablo's Genji means maybe McCree is not going to be the right choice either. If he doesn't have the support to help him get those shots off, there's no Farrah in play anymore either, so it's kind of interesting that they're staying on it. Hikleri is actually going to swap from the Tracer to a Zarya here, and Graviton Surge can be a very nice tool to help you complete this point. Nano Blade is out. Pablo in the backline already. Fine Soldier. He's after Pyro. Pyro goes down, so there's no DPS left. Twinkie taking some slices is probably not going to last too much longer in the suit either. Kart continues to move here, and Budapest are rolling.
Yeah, they sure are. Mainly off the back of Pablo. He's played so well this whole game. Of course, Sorenz on Grenoble has been a hero for the team, but they haven't been able to put much friction on the card at all since the very, very beginning of King's Row. And it looks like Grenoble still in a very, very bad spot. Gonna break it down, but there's only three of Grenoble even near the point. It's all on Sorenz to make this happen. He has TAC visor, but he is one man, and he's also anti-healed too.
Oh, Reinhardt got booped up the side after dropping the Earth Shatters. Z Soccer with a very good heads-up play there, and Sarens is going to go down to a stray Helix Rocket from Resist. There's a Nano Boost actually coming out on McCree.
Okay.
May, excuse me, he's not on McCree anymore, he's on May, and she's going to try to freeze down whatever she can. The wall goes up to prevent any line of sight, but the cart is basically on the spot right now, so Keck and Zarya both can combine.
Oh, stay on, Pyro!
Kills. May is trying to do her best here, but the cart is going to slide even further forward. Z-Soccer gets incredibly low on Lucio, but he keeps line of sight, able to keep himself alive. Keck is still there. Dragon Blade out for Pablo. Attack Visor in the back line from Resist, and they will get the job done. 1 minute, 35 seconds left on the clock.
You know, at moments that felt like Budapest was dominating, but they were held on that first point for so long, and there was a tiny bit of resistance towards the end there. So in the end, they actually don't even set a very good time. 1 minute, 35. You got to be happy about that, but you're not overjoyed by any means. This is a pretty average time to set here on King's Row, and plenty of opportunity for Grenoble to strike back as we switch things up. Grenoble now taking their turn to attack here on King's Row, and we'll see what kind of composition they stick with. It looks like probably orienting towards another dive comp. It's not quite the same dive comp that we saw out of Budapest. This time they are going to be opting for... Oh, well, never mind. It looks like they're going to be running almost the same comp. The only difference, though, is they're rocking the Lucio for that speed boost. Ever important speed boost. But it does not mean that they... It means that they will not have a Mercy constantly following their Pharah around. But the trade-off is pretty decent here with that speed boost.
Yeah, it is interesting. Usually you see the Pharah or Soldier, and when Pharah's in play, you normally see the Mercy added along with. But we haven't seen like a single Resurrection, really, that I can recall changing any fights. So even in the last map when she was there. So they are going to stick with Anna. I think that's probably fine. Pyro is always a good Nano Boost target, and if Pharah can actually stay alive well, can be a good Nano Boost target as well, but Resist on the Soldier this time is going to be looking to shut down Twinkie as often as possible. In the Battle of the Genjis, we've seen Pablo's name pretty frequently in that kill feed. Pyro was on the McCree for a brief time last round, so not sure how he's going to fare on the Genji this time. Doors are about to open, though, and as we see the defense set up, they're going to be going at 2 tank and 2 DPS. Pablo has been great on the Genji, so no reason to switch him off just yet.
Okay, Pharah coming over top, and 76 in a great position to start wailing away at Pharah. In that range, 76 is going to just do so much work. They got to really focus him. If I'm Pharah right now, I'm going to try to get right into the face of 76. Of course, 76 is a good counter to Pharah, but not when Farah's right up in his business like he should be doing right now. It's actually even 5v5 on the point, and looks like Twinkie's listening. Twinkie going to make my words almost come true there for a second, but not quite. Gonna have to back out. Grenoble has been knocked down a peg, and we'll regroup for this next fight.
Resist fell extremely low there at one point, but did manage to get a bio nade to heal himself back up to full, like, immediately. I think that Pancake should have really helped Twinkie against the Soldier. Soldier was off on his own, so if Winston actually drives that engagement, I think they find that Soldier kill no problem. Instead, Pancake went toward the back line and tried to find the healers right away. It just didn't work out. There's a Reinhardt asleep, actually, here, the defending Reinhardt specifically. So the attacking team, Grenoble, actually have a bit of an open window here. Hecleri going to fall extremely low and does go down on the Zarya. Pablo is also out of the mix. Pulse Bomb goes out onto Keck, and it's Grenoble finally finding their rhythm here, everything adding up in their favor. And they are going to march onto the point now, one tick secured, and likely going to be able to finish it out.
Yeah, they're definitely going to be able to cap out here. No point in Budapest trying to rush on in the last possible second. And that's actually a better time, quite a significantly better time set on the first point here for Grenoble, representing France in their hometown Meltdown bar here in the second map here, this best of five. They're going to start off pretty strong on King's Row.
All right, Pancake and the rest surging forward looking for targets, but Twinkie is actually going to be the first one to go down to that Resist Helix Rocket. There's a Nano Boost onto Genji, but why? Pablo has his blade available, but there's nothing really to shoot down or cut up at this point, so he's just going to contest the cart against these couple of supports and then dash on back toward his team. Pancake falls all the way out in the streets there, so defense are going to have plenty of time to set up at this corner. They're actually going to move all the way onto the cart since there were only supports there. Keck just freely walked up, and they're going to take this battle right outside the enemy spawn.
Yeah, they've moved quite far forward here, and this is something we've been seeing teams do more and more. It seems to me, but Grenoble with a bunch of early kills. That's 6 versus 3. There's no way they lose this fight. Now, even though there's some ultimates up for Budapest to try and hold this, I expect that they're not even going to bust them out here. I would be very surprised if they do. Oh, here comes the blade. I don't know about this, Pablo. He's completely outnumbered. Even though he's getting kills, I still don't think this is worth. Because now Pablo just dies.
They're not valuable kills when they're going to respawn 5 feet away and you're going to respawn on the other edge of the universe.
Yeah, exactly.
So Pablo is definitely going to be a rough stagger, but the cart didn't move. So at least, you know, it's going to be a while before he can actually get it back into position. The rest of his team will be in a spot to be able to help to defend better. Soldier already in a pretty good position. Something that you didn't call out during the last fight, Resist actually used his tac visor toward the end and got cut down immediately. So they have no tactical visor here from the high ground. It would have been so good for them in this position, but they're just lacking at this point. And Keck is going to eat a pulse bomb immediately. Goes down very quickly. Graviton Surge out here from the defense does allow them to stay in the battle, though. Pablo right there at the forefront. Both supports down now for the attacking team. And as things shake out here, it looks like Budapest will be okay on the defense. Grenoble needing to probably group again.
Yeah, that feels good, man, for Budapest, as they drew out the sound barrier in that fight as well, so they're going to have a big support ultimate advantage for this next fight. That said, Twinkie gets first blood, and that could be poured. Look at this anti-heal on the Zarya, no chance for her to survive. I almost feel like they should have just dropped the sound barrier right there and then to keep that Zarya alive. Maybe Lucian wasn't quite in position. Now the sound barrier is out. Now the Earth Shatter's out, but no damage being done whatsoever. A couple of wasted ultimates, in my opinion, for Budapest.
Yeah, I think this is like desperation mode, really. They're just hitting the buttons as they get them. But Saren's lobs out a pulse bomb, catches 2 with 1. Gotta love to see that efficiency there. Pyro, back on the cart, is going to finish off Pablo as the final contesting member. But there's a nano visor, actually. They're committing everything on this here. Pancake goes down right away, and if they can get that Lucio should be an easy kill. We've got Pyro actually moving into the back line here trying to take out Anna, but I'm surprised that Nanovisor barely got anything.
I mean, I thought it wasn't a good idea to pop it at all because they were outnumbered, but you know what that Nanovisor did do is it just pushed everyone away from the cart and gave Budapest enough time to get back into the fray there. So it didn't collect any kills. It could have backfired royally. They could have wasted that ult completely. But instead, they actually made enough space to hold on in a very clutch moment. So it worked out in the end.
And importantly, Resist is already halfway up to another tactical visor because after it ended, they did find those kills once the tanks got back into the battle. So Keck is going to dive right in. He's surrounded by 5 people, but the Zarya bubble keeps him alive slightly. Pablo is going to eat a biotic grenade while his blade is out. So in a bit of a danger area here, he does trade with the enemy Anna. So defense perhaps still a little bit favored. Pyro's going to pull out his Dragon Beat now, finds Lucio immediately. Mirage also going to get used and some very low health targets on the point means Budapest should get cleaned out. Look at that kill feed, though. 3 different ults committed by the attacking team to make sure they get this checkpoint. They certainly will do so, but they are at a huge time disadvantage at this point, trying to finish the last stretch with only 2 minutes, and you can see Budapest time with a minute 35 ready for extra rounds. Budapest have to feel good about their chances here.
Oh yeah, absolutely, and the fact that they have a minute 35 specifically, they have over a minute left on the clock, which means that if Grenoble cannot cap even if they do cap in OT, there's no chance for them to win this map.
Right,
by the way, the rules work.
Pushing forward, Graviton Surge is about ready here for Hikari, but they're not even going to need it. They actually win the drive fight here with basically no ultimates, even against the attackers very close with their spawn. But Keck actually did use the Primal Rage there before going down. Pablo is going to be down as well. So if the offense actually regroup here, they have an opportunity to move forward.
Yeah, this is not a bad look now for Grenoble, as that Genji is going to be late to this next fight. But here comes the TAC Visor. Oh my goodness, it's always doing work. Whenever either team is pulling it out, it's always getting value. And opening that up with 2-3 kills. This is looking worse and worse for Grenoble. If you're Grenoble right now, you want to make it happen in this next fight, which is doable. Look at their ultimate advantage. It's going to be massive. If there's a big Earth Shatter, if there's a big, I guess you can't really nano the Genji. Genji could get ult midway through the fight, but they're very close to having 6 ultimates
up. they're going to have to use pretty much everything here to blow the door open, and then I want to see some switches. Like, I don't think Pharah's necessary here anymore, but they're going to give her the nano boost to start this fight off. Earthshatter comes out, catches two. Lucio and Zarya, important targets to catch with that Earthshatter, and they get the kills that they're looking for. Pablo with the Dragon Blade takes out the attacking Ana, so we're in a short supply of healers here as this fight continues to devolve. Tech is going to jump in and just get blown up. Araldos on the attacking Lucio, actually getting in on the action here. 10 seconds left. Not a ton of time, of course. They need to actually finish the map or they will lose on King's Row. So everything right
Pablo.
This, final engagement.
Pablo was just trying to play sneaky and delay the cart there. Oh, Pablo survives. He gets the health back. Wow, he was down to just a pixel of health. He's 1 he's HP, surrounded. As the pros would say.
Unfortunately, he staggered himself even worse, but Pyro also died in that encounter. Farage is going
to come out. Ticking down.
The cart is the only important thing here. Twinkie is going to jump over the side. Zarin finds two with a pulse bomb again. That's incredibly clutch, but can they stay on the cart? Resist has the nano boost as McCree. McCree popping back out here. Gets taken out by Pharah. That's kind of a surprising pick there, but now they're in full contest mode. They need to be making those swaps to just last as long as they can. Overtime is starting to tick down, so if they can just get a couple of kills, this will be a Budapest map, but Twinkie's doing a great job here on Pharah in the last stretch.
Yeah, Twinkie really making it happen for his team. It looks like they should be able to do this, although you can't speak too soon. You've got the stall strategies in play. You've got D.Va in play. That D.Va should have died so much earlier. She ends up getting the kill on Twinkie, yet still, it does look like Grenoble still has the advantage. They have Earthshatter as well if they need it. Looks like they should use that Earthshatter, try to take down Genji, put Genji on his ass. No, Genji's doing too much work. Yes, there you go.
Now Genji's taking a little nap as he gets eliminated, and that's all it takes. Reinhardt waiting for the perfect spot there to actually hit the shatter and gets three kills in the final seconds to make sure that they finish the map. However, you're totally right in that they are screwed now because extra rounds, they are not going to have any time. So they are hoping for a draw at best. And the first minute and a half, I think Budapest were actually pretty slow at grabbing point A last time. So this is definitely drawable, but Budapest, perhaps with the momentum, and now that they have captured A the first time, they have a little bit of more information coming in dry this time. So these extra rounds can certainly be very volatile, and Grenoble will have to be on their best attention, really, to make sure everyone stays up.
Yeah, best case scenario now for Grenoble is a tie. They can only lose or tie. Same thing goes for Budapest. They can only win or tie now, so great position for the team that's already up 1-0 in this best of five. And I don't know, 1 minute 35 is not a ton of time. In fact, actually, if you think about it, Budapest was held on this first point for more than 1 minute and 35 seconds first time around, so certainly a good opportunity for this to be a tie in the end, but Budapest going to be sticking with that dive comp. This time, no Pharah in the comp, so this is more of like the quote-unquote standard dive comp we're seeing now. You still see a lot of Pharah Mercy, don't get me wrong, but this is really the bread and butter of dive comp in, I guess, April of 2017, in the current version of dive comp.
Yeah, if you say dive, I'm picturing this. The only variables come out when the map calls for a Pharah, but at this point, Keck is going to be a lot more careful this time. I think last time, all they needed to do was try and eliminate the soldier quickly, but this time, everyone gets in position, but they get battered. Saren's, Pyro, and Twinkie all find kills very quickly there. Twinkie on the Roadhog is actually a new look for the defense, and that instant kill potential definitely showing up there as he gets a kill onto Alien Hunt as well. So 35 seconds already gone now, and Budapest will need to rally. No one's really close to an ult. Sometimes 90 seconds is enough to get a nano boost, so we'll see if they start to fly out here on the second encounter.
Yeah, I'm going to call it right now. Twinkie is going to be the linchpin for this defense. If he can hook that Winston out of this fight, it's going to change everything. So Twinkie looking for those big hooks on Winston. 5v5. Make that 4v4. Both teams dropping very quickly here. Budapest eking out an advantage, though. This could be exactly what they needed. It's going to have to be a miracle of a delay now for Grenoble. Otherwise, this first point is going the way of Budapest. I don't see any chance at this junction. Yeah, that's going to be it. Budapest taking the second map. King's Row will go the way of the Hungarian squad, representing their hometown very well here in France, in foreign, on foreign territory. They've made it happen, and we're going to a 2-0 scoreline.
Uh-oh. France, you need to, viva la France, you need to get rallied, have some baguettes and croissants and figure out what's going on here, drink some coffee and get back into battle, because right now Budapest is running away with this series. Pablo on the Genji has been a shining star for them. Look at him just walk up to Soldier. That was pretty brutal, just sneaking up on him there and taking out three in an incredibly short span.
He keeps Pablo's it going. Wow.
A great time, yeah. Yeah. 50 limbs. Not
bad. Good stuff for Budapest. And it's going to be Grenoble's pick again. That was Grenoble's map pick. Loser, of course, will be picking. So this is the last time Grenoble will get to pick in this best of five, whether they win or lose. We'll see where they decide to go next.
They just need a little bit. They need a little bit of punch to just match what Budapest is showing right now. Because we saw the first map, all the points were pretty darn close. King's Row wasn't too different. I mean, 90 seconds difference on completing the map. Both sides did complete the map. So still relatively close. But you can see Budapest, I think, if they can deal with Pablo, maybe their chances are a little bit better. That's a lot on the shoulders of, I believe it was Pancake playing the Winston previously. So if he can maybe prioritize Pablo a little bit better, perhaps they'll have a shot. But there's so a couple of the maps remaining in the pool. I believe Hollywood and Route 66 are both in there. Lijiang Tower might be the fifth and final one. So a couple of different options here for Grenoble. I think based on what we've seen so far, maybe Lijiang Tower could be their choice here.
Well, I mean, as you said, Joshy, both of those maps were actually very close when it comes down to it. So we'll see where we head. Will it be Payload? Will it be another King of the Hill? And we're going to just let these teams relax, maybe going for a smoke break or what have you. Guys, again, they are playing live from the Meltdown Bar in Lyon, France. This is the Meltdown Cities Clash Grand Finals, and these teams played within their local Meltdown bars in a bracket against other Meltdown locations. There are 23 or 22 in Europe, three in North America, so to get to this final point. And we have a 1,200 euro prize pool on the line, and of course the main prize here is going to be glory for your hometown, your home squad. I think that's really what's at stake here, if we're being
honest.
Yeah,
you can say that your Meltdown City bar is the best of all of them, definitively, especially if they 3-0, which they are looking capable of at least. But it's going to be the map choice again for Grenoble. 1,200 euro first prize is nice, but obviously second prize, you get a free trip to France. And for Grenoble, that's not maybe too exciting, but at least they get to spend some time with some other Overwatch enthusiasts, have a nice party down at Meltdown Lyon, and meet a bunch of cool people. And I'm sure everyone there is just having a wonderful time. Esports events are always awesome, but when you mix in alcohol and friends, it gets even better.
Oh, yeah. If this extended to North America and I had a local San Francisco branch, I would be playing 100%.
Totally.
That is like the most fun you can ever have, is playing in an organized esports competition, even if it's more casual, even if it's maybe not pro at quite the same level as the pros. We've still got high masters, low GM kind of sprinkled through both of these teams. So they're in the top, 4% of players, something like that? Yeah, so we're still talking about the very cream of the crop in terms of the entire Overwatch player base. A lot of pride on the line in this one.
Get closer. 4K, I think they said that 4K is the top less than 1%, and a lot of these players, like 9 or 10 of them, are actually 4K or better, or have been 4K or better. So some of the best in the world, technically, still.
Oh, wow, I actually just noticed,
Clash.
Pablo's all the way up at 4367. He's top 500 right now. I'm just going to go through some of these player profiles and take a look. Resist is the Rockin' Masters, but he was GM lit earlier this season.
He said he decayed 700.
Oh, ouch. Yeah, we've got multiple people on this Hungarian squad that have been top 500 this season or currently are top 500. So no surprise to see them playing so well here.
Good stuff. And you're talking about how you would definitely be playing and how fun it is. I think it's more fun if you know that pro players won't be there, because you actually do have a chance of getting some prizing or winning some games. I can only imagine like entering an open tournament and having to face, like, in StarCraft 2 days at least, just having like Marine King in front of you or Pulse in the open bracket, something like that. I've only ever really competed at one pro event, and it was in Mortal Kombat. I don't know if you've heard this story, FishStix, or remember it all.
I probably did hear it at some point, but refresh my memory, Josh.
It was MLG 2012, and I was working at IPL. I was no longer part of Complexity, so MLG Anaheim, they decided they didn't want to give me a press badge anymore, for probably because I was working at IPL. So I circumvented this by buying a player badge. StarCraft was sold out, so I played Mortal Kombat on console. Didn't even own the console, didn't own Mortal Kombat. I went to Nick Allen's house, your good buddy, my good buddy, and he taught me one combo on Liu Kang, and I took that to the tournament and got my butt destroyed, basically, by both of my first two round opponents, and just hung out the rest of the time with a nice player badge and did whatever I wanted, press-wise.
Yeah, fighting games are, like, the hardest ever, I swear. It's funny because they're obviously, like, much easier to understand for a layman. What's going on? Who's winning? Epic combos are exciting to everybody, but I feel like you could argue, like, the knowledge you need for a MOBA is, like, up here. The knowledge you need for an FPS, like, you could classify all these things. This is a highly subjective discussion here, but the knowledge you need to be even mediocre at fighting games is obscene. The frame data, it's like, it's just crazy. Because I played about 350 plus hours of Street Fighter 4, and after that, like, over the course of about 2 years, after that, I still couldn't do my regular bread and butter combos,
man,
consistently, like, all when I needed to. Because it's like literally one or two frame windows for even the most basic combos. And, you know, sometimes, like, that combo doesn't work against this character, and you just have to know that. Yes, fighting games are ridiculous, man. There's so much hidden in there. It's absolutely
You need nuts. A lot of very, very strong short-term memory, and your reflexes and accuracy need to be both insanely high for
character knowledge, yeah.
Yeah.
Everything.
Yeah. So we are actually going to get a map pick here, and it looks like both teams are ready. They did, in fact, go for a smoke break. They confirmed that in the chat. But Lijiang Tower is actually going to be loaded up here for game number 3. And Nepal was pretty close, so I think that they do definitely stand a chance here. I think last time Pablo definitely was doing a good job, and Hikari on the Tracer were both big tools for Budapest. So if Grenoble can match that Tracer and Genji output, I think they'll be giving us a pretty good match here. But as soon as everyone is ready to go, we'll be entering game number 3. This is just a best of 5 series. And to remind you guys, Budapest Random Raptors are up 2-0 in the series against Grenoble Mountain Butchers. So everything is on the line here. This could be a tournament point on this next map.
A lot of pressure on this next one. And of course, there's no opportunity for ties at all, because we're going to King of the Hill. It's going to be Lijiang Tower. The first King of the Hill map we saw was 3-0 in favor of Budapest. But at least Grenoble had a fighting chance in every one of those points. So not counting them down and out yet. I'm actually, Joshy, kind of impressed with the average skill rating of these teams. Almost everybody's in the GM range. There's only two people that are not in GM on either team.
Yeah, one
across,
on either side
across
or something
both
like that.
Teams. Yeah, so these are actually pretty high level teams, considering that they organized around a bar atmosphere. That's pretty cool to see. I like it.
It makes me wonder who didn't actually make it through, right? If there were even more GMs and things on the way. And I'm curious about some of the other teams as well, but it looks like both teams are ready, so any moment now we should be launching out. Thanks to all the viewers showing up here for the English cast. I appreciate you checking out some, I guess, grassroots competition is really what we should call it, as these guys are basically just locals that are playing together and earned this trip to Lyon to battle it out for 1,200 euros.
Yeah, grassroots esports is actually, I feel like it's probably like the weakest part of like esports has grown so much over the last couple of years, and there's been all of this money coming from venture capital firms, mainstream sports team owners and players, all of these different angles. Money is just pouring into the scene, Every publisher and developer is supporting their titles in ways that have never happened before. But we kind of, I feel like we kind of lack a really, really strong grassroots community in a lot of major esports titles. So events like this are awesome. It's not only for not necessarily like the highest level players, but like I love the fact that it's focused around locations. You know, having the local esports scene growing, that I think is something that people haven't focused enough on, and that's why
totally
I got to give a lot of props to Meltdown for what they're doing. 25 locations.
Yeah,
25
so
bars.
Meltdown, they're obviously perfectly suited for this, right? So they've got computers in every bar, and like you said, a good international reach with multiple countries having these essentially LAN centers with booze. So Meltdown really did kind of make the perfect storm, and it, you know, they only had a few locations even a few years ago, so they've been growing like wildfire. And you and I are big esports nerds, FishStix. We could talk about dollars and cents, we could talk about grassroots and pro as like all day long, but honestly what it comes down to is, how are you going to make your money back, right? If you've only got $1,000, you got to spend wisely to figure out, you know, how much engagement you're going to get and all that stuff. But Meltdown are in a perfect position to take advantage of even just a little bit of spend, because they know that people are already coming to their establishments. And that's something that, like, in the United States at least, McDonald's did a trial run of like a Hearthstone fireside gathering. If they ever actually make that union and fireside gatherings are taking place in McDonald's countrywide or worldwide, that could actually be enormous. I'm really hopeful for something like that. It doesn't, you know, not necessarily McDonald's, not necessarily Hearthstone, but something like that that could just be like an enormous chain buying in on esports. I think we're going to see a big change in the way that grassroots is viewed. But
yeah,
who knows? It could be a while before we see something like that. I just hope it's sooner than later.
I tell you what, I would be going to my local Meltdown bar, rooting for my local team if they were like playing in this tournament, like crazy. I would be in the crowd just screaming my head off. That would be lots and lots of fun. Hopefully we see this kind of concept expand globally. I think it has a lot of potential for sure. All right, here we go.
Maybe by this time next year, you'll be watching the San Francisco Tracers take on the LA Winstons or something like that.
In OWL.
Right. Of course, none of us know anything about that, so we're just going to move on back to this game here, City Clash, game number 3. Door's about to open here. We've got Pharah locked and loaded on one side, but Resist is on the Widowmaker here for Budapest, and Budapest have the advantage moving into this game 2-0 already. If they can lock it up on Lijiang Tower, they will be your champions.
Interesting to see Widowmaker on this point. Not something you see all that often, but it could end up working out here for Budapest, especially against the Pharah. Pharah, one of the easier targets to lock onto as a Widowmaker, and it's pretty even still on the point. Actually, 4 versus 4, so both teams dropped 2, still fighting. The only problem with Widowmaker is she has no beef. She can't really fight in a team fight like other DPS can't. So you're really relying on getting those early picks, and right now the fight rages on, but small advantage now eking out here for Grenoble.
Important to note, Pablo has switched off of Genji onto Anna. Keck has moved from Winston over to Genji. Alien Hun has moved from Anna over to Winston. So everybody's shifting roles here, and Grenoble are taking full advantage of that. They destroyed everybody there in the final moments before grabbing up the point, and Alien Hun shows up right as they do so. So they just surround and destroy him as well.
Perhaps Budapest is just having some fun now. They're of course up 2-0. The second game was pretty damn close. The first game, maybe not so much. So maybe they're just they're very, very confident. They're gonna just mess around a little bit. I wouldn't be surprised if we see them switch back to their more normal compositions if this doesn't work here on the first point.
Well, Grenoble already secured a pretty good lead. 30% is not too bad, and Pharah's doing a good job avoiding that Widowmaker. Pablo is going to secure the first kill here for Budapest, and that actually puts Grenoble on the back foot. They're going to be forced off the point, but Twinkie nails a nice rocket there to help eliminate the Genji. Now Widowmaker is down as well, but Twinkie is suddenly on his own. The rest of his team did fall during the course of that ground war. Hikari on the Roadhog pushing out a lot of damage that they couldn't deal with.
I believe that was actually 2 boops. The Lucio got a boop, and I think the Winston booped someone off as well there in that fight. So good positioning, or maybe poor positioning, coming out of Grenoble on the ledge there.
Well, Resist is back in action on Widow, still just pouring shots into Pancake there as he goes down. That's going to be Budapest getting more percentage for themselves.
Yep. All right, they kept the point and holding on very nicely. That's a clean wipe. You'd hear that bell chime if you were playing in this game right now, because that was a team wipe, and now Grenoble has to go back to the drawing board. They have a ton of ultimates to their name. The only thing they don't really have right now is that high noon. They just did switch over to Reinhardt as well, so switching their comp up a little bit. And here they come. They'll probably be engaging with the sound barrier here to get this thing started. Oh, here comes the tac visor as well. This could do a lot of work.
Saren's just running forward as fast as he can to try to find some targets. They all scattered whenever they heard the ults go off, as you normally do. Grenoble is going to be able to flip the point, though. Twinkie just jumps straight over there, knowing that if anyone tried to contest him, he would just hit Barrage and take him down. But Hikari on the Roadhog still being very valuable here. Grabs Reinhardt into him, and Genji helps secure that kill. We've got Grenoble still on the back foot here, being forced over to the ledge, as it's going to be Alien Hunt diving onto the point. Everyone else follows suit, and it's going to be Budapest flipping it back. Barrage into the doorway, doesn't get anything. Unfortunately for Twinkie, he goes down during the barrage.
Damn, that was a little bit questionable play. I mean, they could have fought on the point at least to try and delay that a little bit longer. It wouldn't have given them too much more percentage, but always good practice to, even if you're losing the fight, if you know you're going to lose the fight, at least fight on the point. That said, still plenty of time for Grenoble to get back. They have at least one more solid push here, maybe a second if they engage right now, but probably just this last engagement here.
I think this is going to be it. Earthshatter comes out and does not catch the whole hog of a Hikari. I don't know if the Winston bubble screwed him up or line of sight alone, but it was not enough. Resist is just free firing into that hallway and getting enough damage pushed out that the tanks are getting the job done. Saren's and Twinkie both find a couple of kills, but there's no one left alive now after the bloodbath that took place. Budapest is going to take it 100% there. Saren's returns to the point just a smidge too late, can't get a toe on the point, and that will be Budapest securing a 1-0 lead on Lijiang Tower.
Well, a sad face out of Twinkie there. I think he realizes that they switched up the comp. They're playing with something unorthodox, and yet still Budapest comes out on top. Seems like King of the Hill is the name of the game for this team.
King of the Hill working out great for Budapest, even with the role swaps. Pablo not even needing to carry here, just playing the nice, safe Ana role in the back while the rest of the team does their stuff. Resist, if he does actually lock in a Reaper, I'll be quite surprised, but on the other side, looks like Mercy might be employed here. Resurrex could actually change the story of the way things are going so far. It's worth a shot.
Yeah, this Budapest team is trying all kinds of things now. This is an interesting comp indeed. It's a very standard like Reinhardt-based comp, and then you've got a Genji floating around. It's pretty interesting. We'll see if Reaper comes into play here.
Seren's going to be the first one down there. Nice charge from Alien Hunt to get that done. And Pancake also going to fall, so Budapest, man, they are just rolling through here. The momentum fully on their side. Twinkie gets hooked in and destroyed, and Hikari's Roadhog is just as good as his Tracer here as they grab the point.
Oh no, Mercy! Mercy gets caught out. Resist picking up a free kill there. Mercy was kind of in no man's land. I'm not sure what she could have done to avoid that untimely death, though. Let's see if ultimate's going to be coming up first here for Budapest as they're taking positioning on the map. If you take a look, Resist is kind of playing sneaky high ground Reaper. He'll be dropping down as soon as the enemy team gets in the right position for him to do so.
But we have Pharah Mercy.
Yeah.
Pharah Mercy are getting some shots out. Saren's finds a kill there. Twinkie onto Pablo removes the Ana threat. So no Ryan, no Ana. Unfortunately, Mercy is going to bite the dust as well there. Hikari still just sweet spotting them with Roadhog, even at a distance. Earthshatter comes out, catches Roadhog, and Pancake charges through him to nothing. But this 40% from Budapest could be coming to an end soon. Keck and Pyro both pulling out the Dragon Blades there. A couple of kills on both sides, but Grenoble have lost their advantage on the point itself, and Budapest
are
still...
Oh no! They had a big man advantage in that fight! Significant! But because the Reinhardt was so low, he had to back away, he could not shield his team, and they end up losing it. So Grenoble, after actually doing quite well in that fight, you know, blade versus blade coming out on top, they completely lose it, and now they only have pretty much two fights left at most. They have to engage now if they even want that many. And it's going to be the first kills going immediately towards Budapest once again. So this could be the last fight. This next fight could be the last one. They have the ultimates to do it. They will have Tac Visor. They will have Pharah Barrage. But they don't have Nano. So no Nano on the Tac Visor. They're going to have to do it the old-fashioned way.
Well, they do have a res available, and so far it hasn't even been shown a single time. Araldos just keeps dying with it, unable to make good use of it. Resist uses the Death Blossom in the background, but doesn't get anything for it. Barrage actually going to find two here for Grenoble. So it looks like they will stave off the 100% humiliation, but it's going to be still a tough task for them to hang on for a full 100%. At least they do have lots of ults to work with. They didn't really burn anything except a Barrage. To gain the point, and now Twinkie's going to swap off a Pharah onto Zarya to help out even further.
All right, we do have high ground for Sorenz. With Tac Visor as well, here comes flanking high ground. He maybe pulled the trigger too early, but no, Keck was out of position. Sorenz actually, very ballsy play, getting right in the face of that Reinhardt, but it paid off. Grenoble holding on. Look how many ults they have, Joshy.
As long as you can snag one, it's good, and you're right, there's still four ultimates available for the defense, but Twinkie is still just building up there, and Twinkie actually gets charged. Pancake down as well. There's the big res we were looking for there. Two tanks actually in the backline, and Earthshatter comes in immediately onto Hilarious Roadhog. Removing him from the fight is great for them, and Grenoble should be able to hang on here. Nice Helix Rocket from Sorenz onto the Lucio as well, and Budapest continue to drop like flies. 50% now for Grenoble. They have definitely brought themselves back in here. They have a chance on control center. They just need to hang on a couple more times, and now they only have that Genji blade to work with. Keck earlier did get a double kill with his, so they need to be cautious on this one.
No high ground this time for Sorenz. Just going to be playing right on the point. Both teams will clash now. Both teams used quite a few ultimates in that last fight, but Keck pulling out the blade. Going to get the first kill. Resist picks up the second, so now this is looking extremely dire. Can Sorenz pull off some sort of miracle? Does not look like it's going to happen. This is the point going. We are going down to the very last chance here for Grenoble to pick this up and continue their dream. They want to continue the dream here as to become the Meltdown City champions. It's going to be tough, though. This is a tall mountain to climb at this point, as Budapest has looked completely dominant for the most part here on, well, the second King of the Hill map of the day. It's about to go 3-0.
Oh, man. So Jason Kaplan showed up saying, is the score 0-11? I just noticed that.
So I actually realized what I did. I resized the text boxes.
Yeah.
But, you know, you can resize it like the opposite direction on accident. Like, I pulled the wrong corner. Oh. So my text box is backwards. It's reversed. So if I had it 2, it would be a backwards 2 right now. So that's why I'm just going to tally it for now.
Works for me. There's a Junkrat in play here, by the way. Keck is going to start. Was that a Junkrat? Yeah, Hikari's starting out on the rat, but all three of those attacking Budapest players are going to get nuked down very quickly. So Grenoble, happy to have the Junkrat on the field if it means they're going to grab the point first.
Yeah, Twinkie actually got the boop early in that fight, and I don't know. I don't want to say it, Josh, but it almost feels like Budapest is kind of trolling a little bit at this point. The Raptors, they've been playing with very unorthodox combos now, with their two DPS being like the least consistent DPS in the game of Overwatch right now. Let's see if they can make it happen, though, with this unorthodox combo. Looks like, actually almost already with the Junkrat tire. No dice this time. Pharah flying above. Twinkie's been doing work with Pharah so far here on guard.
Well, Resist is back on the Widowmaker. He actually lands a headshot onto Reinhardt, and Budapest are actually slowly but surely finding some kills. That was a much earlier res than we saw in the previous round, though, and it's going to be Grenoble bringing everybody back up here. They've got all six healthy on the point now, and they're able to just shoot freely into that spawn window there. Hikari on the Junkrat. I'm surprised that he's still alive at all on that Junkrat, but Anna's actually just pouring darts into him now as the rest of Budapest get together here. They're about to make a leap in. There goes the Nano Boost onto Alien Hunt.
Oh, just before the hammer was dropped, gets slept, but Pancake's still going to be able to drop it, still going to be able to knock down a few, but it's Budapest striking back right away, making this happen. Pancake, the last one for Grenoble on the point. He actually almost gets a couple of kills with that Fire Strike, but we'll go down. That said, decent push there by Grenoble. They've gotten it all the way up to 65 percentage points, which means a single take could be all they need here. See if they can do it. Twinkie has been great on Pharah. Can he continue this momentum?
Barrage could be a valuable tool for them. Tactical visor as well, but Pablo is going to be the first one down. Tactical visor is going to be triggered here by Sorenz, but he gets focused down very quickly there by Budapest. Riptire's out, and it does find the kill on Mercy, who did not have a res generated just yet. Now everyone's falling very low on health, and no healers in sight here for Grenoble. Though they do flip it, I do expect Budapest to be able to just march in here and grab it back.
Yeah, that was unfortunate for Twinkie there. Will we have no res in play here just yet? They're going to keep actually ticking this up much longer than you might have expected. They're getting all the way up to 80%+, and they actually draw out the sound barrier from Z-Soccer, which is a little bit unfortunate for Budapest. They did not need to drop that barrier down. That said, they are going to be able to retake eventually at some point, right?
Maybe not. Twinkie is back in here, grabbing kills before going down, and now Mercy's back in play. She's at 90% toward a res. There's an Earth Shatter coming out here from the side of, actually, Budapest? No, they don't even have a Reinhardt, so Pancake slamming down there. I'm so confused what just happened, but either way, Resist finds a kill on Sorenz. Pancake finds Alien Hunt. Grenoble still at 99%. As they get these last kills onto the red team, they will secure their first round victory on any control map here. Actually, Kraviton Surge. Change of things here. Z-Soccer's back in the mix, and Budapest are not letting this go easily.
Yeah, but they will have to eventually, as Grenoble gonna get their first King of the Hill point of the day. It's gonna be on Garden Phase, which makes sense. I mean, Twinkie has been playing fantastically with Pharah, and that is one of the best points in the game for Pharah, if you're asking me. So many opportunities to boot people off multiple different ledges. That said, Budapest, with some very unorthodox picks for the first, I don't know, two-thirds of that map, running with a Widowmaker and a Junkrat. I think they weren't playing too seriously. We'll be switching things up, but they're switching things up again. Like, they're continually doing these kind of weirder comps. This is actually my, like, okay, standard dive comp just with the McCree. Makes sense now for Budapest.
It is interesting that McCree is going to be their variety character here. Hikari actually moving over to the D.Va for the first time is kind of interesting, but I think Roadhog actually was doing him a pretty good service last time they were here at the control center, but who knows, we'll see what actually goes out from the attackers here. Twinkie and Araldos on the Pharah Mercy, still Pyro on the Genji, and as the first fight breaks out, it looks like Reinhardt is actually going to be keeping his team in pretty good health there, and it's going to be the Budapest players falling first.
Uh-oh. Budapest, you can't get too cocky now. You are up 2-0 in the best of five. You are up 2-1 in this control map. But it could all slip away if they get too cocky, continue to play these off-kilter compositions. Pablo was dominant with Genji earlier. Now he's sticking to Ana for some reason. So I feel like Budapest, when the going gets tough, they're going to switch back to what was working beforehand. But giving Grenoble signs of life here.
I think you're right, and Pancake is going to get the kill on Reinhardt immediately. Alien Hun actually, I think he was on Winston the first time through, so it's kind of interesting he comes back as Rein. But as we have Keck actually dashing through the enemy Genji and Rein, Pancake is going to go down, Pablo is down, and it's still a 4v4 on the point. Barrage is going to be used by Twinkie and does find the kill very, very quickly onto Lucio. D.Va is going to get popped out of her suit as well, and Grenoble should be able to hang on. Pyro trying to find that enemy Genji does so, and Grenoble looking very strong at this point.
Yeah, Grenoble still holding on, 45% and counting up. It does look pretty even on the ultimates here, although that said, I spoke too soon. A couple ultimates just popped here for Grenoble. They have a huge advantage, particularly with that sound barrier. Gonna give them a ton of survivability in this next fight. They're gonna engage, starting with a big Earth Shatter, knocking down three or four right off the bat, and that's all they need to use. They actually end up dropping the Dragon Blade as well, a little bit erroneously if you ask me, but no harm, no foul. They still got ults to boot, and they are still ticking on up. Only one fight remains now for Budapest.
And Keck is just going to launch himself off the ledge to rejoin his team in spawn. There is a hidden agent here. Resist is up on the high ground, and Sorenz is about to run right into him. Resist maybe trying to kill the Mercy, but he actually pays the price in that 2v1. It does not pay to be sneaky here, and it's a 5v6 now for Budapest trying to come in here. Tactical visor triggered by Sorenz up on the high ground. Keck is going to get a nano boost, but also gets pinned. Excellent charge there from Pancake to shut him down. 95% on the point now, and Earth Shatter should be enough to maybe secure this, but Sound Barrier's going to go out. Twinkie and Sorenz still plenty of room to fire from. The res comes in, picks up two. Reinhardt and Pharah back in battle now, and Grenoble should lock this one up.
Yeah, they certainly are going to here as a control center. Gotta go the way of Grenoble. Barring any kind of miracle, you still have D.Va on the point. It's, still looking okay. As long as no one dies to this, nope, no one's dead to that. Still a major advantage for Grenoble, but they've got to start getting some kills.
Yeah, I think Pablo's going to walk right into the Earthshatter. That's like the third or fourth Earthshatter this round here for Pancake. He's doing a great job with the Rhine, but Hikleri on the D.Va is going to lose the suit off the point. Cannot continue to contest, and Grenoble grab 2 points back rather quickly here. I do wonder if our team from Hungary is going to go ahead and swap back to that original comp now, or if they're going to allow a fourth game potentially to happen here. What do you do in this position where you're all in the same room having fun, knowing that you're going to party together in just a few moments, but do you stretch out the event needlessly, or do you just try and drop the hammer and get the job done here?
I don't know. Pablo selecting Sombra for a minute, then going to Hanzo. Yeah, this dude's trolling. I think. Okay, Pablo, it's going to let Keck. Troll. Keck stick with Genji, but they are on a more standard composition here, at least. Move an alien Hun back to the honor roll here as we move on. And it's going to be Market. There you go.
Yep, the old market. Night market here on Lijiang, and Pancake moving forward here as Reinhardt. Someone actually fell really low. Resist, only about half health there at the beginning. Z-Soccer actually getting focused now. The red team's Lucio, but as the battle moves on to the point here, Twinkie manages to
trade
McCree there. Yeah, go ahead.
No, sorry, I was just reacting to them killing each other. It's pretty nice play there from Twinkie to survive. I thought McCree had that one, but Budapest eking out a small advantage. It's just one man. Make it two. Is that a boop? I think that's a boop, potentially.
It could have just been the damage, I think, there, because Genji's normally able to get back up pretty easily.
Yeah, it's true. That said,
Budapest will grab the point first, though.
Yep. And now ultimate danger zone. Match point here for Grenoble. If they don't end up winning this one, they are out of the tournament. It's going to be Budapest taking the win. They've fought back in the last possible moments, but Hikleri doing very nice to get a couple kills for himself early in this fight. Going so deep, getting 3 kills in a row. That is staggering to the max, and this is working for Budapest so far. They're in a little bit of a dangerous position, though, dropping that Winston Barrier. No more Winston Barrier. Hikleri is still here. He's waiting.
Yeah, he's been super ballsy on the Tracer all series long. When he was actually playing it earlier in the first two games, he would just get in the mix against 4 or 5 people, no problem, and just rewind out. But we have Barrage going off here. Twinkie finds a kill onto the enemy Anna very quickly. There's a nano-boosted Winston out in the courtyard, but he's not zapping anything, so not able to make use of that damage. Pancake finds a kill there for Grenoble, and they do manage to flip the point off of those ultimates. So 51% for Budapest. Pretty close to their achievable goal here, but Grenoble are battling back. Serens finds 2 kills in quick succession to send them back to the spawn. Budapest will need to regroup here, but they have a Dragonblade and Primal Rage to work with when they get back.
All right, and of course, Grenoble holding on to that res as well, so if the Dragonblade comes out, gets a few kills, they can negate that entirely with just one ultimate. Serens has been very clutch with the attack visors as well, but he goes down very early. The res might be what it comes down to here. Yes, big res going to take 3 people back up. Soundbearer dropped as well. Still holding on to attack visor. We'll see if this gets popped any second. It will be popped, but here comes Winston again. Very bad position for Serens. Not able to make much use of this attack visor whatsoever. He does survive, though, so Grenoble's still doing okay on the point. They still have a man advantage. It's actually even now, so 5 versus 5 as things continue to move forward. No ultimates for either team at this point in time. Tracer getting close for Budapest, but Grenoble holding on.
Yeah, that's a pretty surprising. Big fight there. Actually, it looks like Heraldos is going to die, unfortunately. So does Twinkie. Saren's going to fall to the Pulse Bomb, and Hikleri has been incredibly accurate with the stickies, I think, across this series whenever he is on Tracer. 66% for Grenoble. Looking like it will expire now, 69% for them, as 55% and climbing for Budapest. They are on the final stretch here of trying to take this City Clash Tournament Championship. If they can get it done here on the night market, they will be the winners of this extremely long and awesome grassroots series. But we've got the attackers kind of all over the place here. Finally, they do get grouped together. Heraldos really trying to get up toward that res.
Oh no, Grenoble, this is your last chance. Okay, they might have one more opportunity after this fight. The kills are going immediately the way of Budapest. Can they all die quick enough? If they get, any of them get staggered here, that might be lights out. Twinkie, and where is Twinkie? Twinkie needs... Oh, he's back at spawn.
He was the first one dead. Yeah.
Okay, he's first one dead. Last chance. Tournament life on the line. Just 7 seconds left. It's all on Grenoble to get in right here and now. Here comes a High Noon. The High Noon zoning everyone out and resist. Clutchest High Noon of the tournament. Biggest play that we've seen today is going to shut this down. Grenoble down and out. Tail between their legs. Has to go home without the victor here. It's going to be Budapest taking it. GG, Joshy.
Excellent games there for us here, and play the match is actually going to go to Z Soccer. Had to be a double boop. You described a double boop, right?
So yeah. I think
that's probably what we're going to see here. Yeah, Pyro, yeah. Pancake, Serenz, all. He gets credit for all of them, and nice.
Gets the headshot, yeah. Nice.
Cool. So we got the rarity of the Lucio play of the match, and see some of these cards coming out here. Hyclary with 51 limbs. On the Tracer, and he wasn't even Tracer the whole time. He actually played a fair bit of Hog and other things as well. So Hyclary, a nice shining spot there for the random Raptors. Of course, we were giving all the praise to Pablo when he was on the Genji, but it seems like they've got two Genji players on the squad. Keck did an admirable job as well.
Yeah, absolutely, and that's going to be it. Grenoble, they fought hard. They had some good plays and against adversity. I mean, looking at the SR, Budapest did have the advantage going into this. They had two players... I've been top 500 this season, one of them currently top 500, so not hugely surprised to see this team with a bit more experience in their belt take the win here. But yeah, that's going to be 1,200 euros, a trophy, and tons of pride going to Hungary, Budapest. Of all places, the Meltdown Bar from Budapest is going to take home the victory in this one. Of course, also got to give a shout out to the sponsors of this tournament, Discord and Aloresto by Just Eat. I think that's like their Uber Eats over there. I'm not totally sure. But also big shout outs to Meltdown in general for inviting us to cast this tournament. Had fun doing it. Joshy and I got our first chance to cast together in many, many months. So hopefully you guys enjoyed that broadcast and got a chance to see a little bit of grassroots Overwatch coming out of Europe. And that's pretty much it for the broadcast. Joshy, any last words before we sign off the short and sweet grand final broadcast?
No, just thank you to Meltdown for having us here. I, again, loved the time that I had there in Paris at the Meltdown Bar. I hope that they continue to expand into North America and throw events like this so that we can participate as well. But happy to see the capital of Hungary coming away with the victory here and giving themselves a bit of notoriety. And Grenoble Mountain Butchers, great attempt, of course. They kept it pretty close for the first two games, but Budapest just proving to be too mighty for them. Congratulations to them for taking second place. Congratulations to Budapest for winning the whole thing. And I hope that everyone there at the Meltdown Bar in Lyon has a terrific night tonight, talking about Overwatch, having some drinks, and just having a great time overall. So that's it for me. You can find my stuff, obviously, on AskJoshy on Twitter and Twitch. And I'll see you guys at the next Overwatch tournament.
Yep. Hopefully see you guys very, very soon. Meltdown, please come to the U.S. We want you. We're ready. I want a SF location. I'm sure Joshy wants a SoCal location as well. Anyway, that's going to do it for the Meltdown Cities Clash. Once again, congrats to our champions, Budapest, the Random Raptors from Budapest. That's going to be it for the broadcast. Take it easy, y'all. We'll see you next time.